Okay, good afternoon. This is the difficult stretch, and if I had power here, which I don't have, I would say let's all sit in front on the floor. Let's make this a cozy conversation, because I suspect that we have fundamental agreements this afternoon, unlike this morning. How can we argue about victims? Are there arguments to be had? Who are proper victims? Who are legitimate victims? Whose victimhood pulse next to our heartbeat? Are some victims more legitimate than others? Are victims passive and pathetic? Sorrowful figures? Do victims have agency? Yes, after all, we talk about survivors of rape, but no longer of victims of rape. Do all victims experience a kind of similar existential reality? Or should we pause and say they are victims and victims? How should we approach the matter of victimhood? What kind of theoretical perspectives will feature this afternoon? After all, this is only the first South African homicide research colloquium. And I think the big achievement, Guy, thus far is that we've been able to have this morning debates about the way we construct homicide, how we construct perpetration, and how we are going to construct victimhood. I think that's no small achievement, and the multidisciplinary nature of the audience here. So I'm not sure what awaits us this afternoon. Will it be the grand positivist empiricism? Will it be the slow phenomenology of approach? Will it be the deep anthropological? Will it be the radical constructurism that we've heard about this morning? Or may there be an evolutionary psychologist lurking amongst us, who will then step forward and take out the ultimate text, which is called Daly and Wilson, Homicide? Yes, there are evolutionary psychologists who are brave enough to begin to map the genetic triggers in the story about homicide. So there's much to do, but we have the pleasure this afternoon of listening to three contributions. And I thought initially it was a bit of a strange mix, because the big heading says victims, as if we have not also spoken about victims earlier. Who gets murdered in South Africa seems to be squarely a question that we could pose here in our discussion on victimhood. Then we shift very much to unwanted pregnancies, dumped, aborted fetuses and babies. And then slightly out of line with the label of victims, there is a snapshot around fire-related homicides. But I'm told that this was a function of some scheduling that took place, that Lorna was supposed to have spoken here. But I'm sure we can cope with that. Can we? Good. So first in line, we have Lizette Lancaster and Ellen Kamman, and they're going to do a double act. But I have to say something, Lizette, about you. But you said I should just say that you are connected to the ISS and that you work more or less within the Crime and Justice Information Hub. Is that all that do? Okay. But she holds many degrees and has worked widely on issues relating to socioeconomic research. So, Lizette, that's you, and then your partner is Ellen Kamman, who's also attached to the Crime and Justice Information Hub, and Ellen has a master's degree in biomedical health sciences. So, you're invited to talk about victims of homicide.
Good afternoon, and thank you so much for the opportunity. I think our session looks like what we are discovering in terms of homicide, and that is that it's an incredibly complex phenomena that we're all just trying to unpack in our own way. Ours have been retitled, just as our abstract, after some more analysis, to be risky locations. Oops. And now it's gone. Risky locations, exploring a methodology for comparing socioeconomic characteristics of high murder areas. So, where do these murders take place without falling into the usual traps? I'll tell you a little bit about us, an overview of the violent crime situation that people have been discussing this morning, factors contributing to crime and violence, and then Ellen will deal with the research, I'll deal with the research overview, then the methodology analysis and conclusion and considerations. We're an independent African policy research institute, and my division works on public discourse on crime, its prevention, the functioning of the criminal justice system, and other people do corruption work, so that's why. And we try and do it through mixed methodologies, such as conducting research, qualitative, quantitative, analyzing policy, and disseminating information. Part of that is the Crime and Justice Information Hub. I was pleased to know that some of you still use it. Thank you very much. And what we try to do with it is to collect as much information as possible on crime and justice work and data, especially that is publicly available, and provide it in a user-friendly format. But also try and get the analysis done that will complement the information there. And this is how this project was born. Now, one of the things that we have been doing at the ISS for more than two decades is monitoring South African crime trends. And we see that in the past 21 years, there have been fluctuations, but that crime overall looked pretty much the way it did 20 years ago, with slight variations if we look at the overall crime trends. However, within these major trends lie specific nuances. For instance, murder more than halved, but house in the past decade, 21 years, or 20 years actually, and house robbery more than doubled in the past decade. So this hides a lot of different nuances, and that's why it's really important for us to understand crime on an ongoing basis and use the tools that we have and the information out there to try and unpack it in our communities and what it means for us in our different fields. So that is what murder has been doing. You can see that more than half, in the past decade, it's more than 27% drop, but we also see increases in the past 2 years. And by all indications, when the crime statistics get released in the next couple of weeks, we will see further increases in murder, especially. But also in other crimes like robbery, if the leaked crime stats for Gauteng is anything to go by. So what does this mean, these increased murders? Who are they? And how did we get from this amazing picture of abnormally high rates, but at least significant drops, as Jean has pointed out, and why is there this upswing again? What do we know of these extra crimes? Is it true what Arnaud Lemieux said last year on radio after the crime stats were released, that the 330, almost 330 murders in the Western Cape, for instance, were all gang-related? Do we have evidence to back that up? So the murder statistics, and Ellen will speak about that, and all crime statistics get released on a national and provincial level. And they also give us the murder or the crime rates for those, for provinces and for the national figure. It's not always correct, but we try and check it. But what we see is that there are significant differences in different provinces. And most notably, the Eastern Cape and Western Cape have pronounced murder rates compared to the rest of the country, and Gauteng's murder rate is surprisingly under the average. but this is a far cry from the international average in 2013 of 6.2 homicides per 100,000. So, the crime stats will be released in the next 2 to 3. So they get released, but they're already 6 months out of date. They are released on a national, provincial, and station level, but they don't give us monthly or quarterly variations. There are 29 categories, but data is not sufficiently disaggregated. If we look at sexual assault or offences, for instance, it's got more than 50 other categories that fall under it. Population data per precinct is not available, and therefore, the crime rate cannot be calculated below a provincial level. The statistics tell us nothing about the victim, the perpetrator, the location, or the circumstances of murder. And we'll see if there's a way that we can bridge some of this. We know from what has been said earlier on that in the cases where we know the perpetrator, according to SAPS in 2008, 80% of the victims in murder is known to the perpetrators are known to the, or victims are known to the perpetrators and vice versa. Some are even family members, as we've heard this morning. And most are described as social behavior. But as Andrew has pointed out, those are where the perpetrators were known to the victims. We do not know what it is now. This is a long time ago. And I suspect that there are many more cases that have got to do with that 16% that you see there that's got murders as a result of other crimes, like robberies. However, we know from international research and the work in this room and others that very often violence, like homicide, are interpersonal violence. And the World Health Organization has actually given us a really nice framework, or advocated the ecological framework, which you all know, which describes the range of factors or risk factors that could be associated. And some of you focused, and this morning was absolutely amazing, because it is so nice to hear these other sides of the individual, the relationships. But what Ellen and I have been trying to do is take what we know of these crime statistics, these horrid crime statistics that are like monsters every year that we try and unpack, and how we can link it with other data sets to make it more meaningful. How can we do that? Can we do it at all? So our experiment has to do with more the outer limits of this, the community and societal aspects, and some of those indicators that you see there. So what we've done is we've developed socioeconomic profiles for policing precincts, so the station-level crime statistics, using the 2011 census small area layers. So we've linked the crime statistics at a precinct level with the census data. As a result, we know, for instance, and we could confirm what international research tells us, that almost half of all murders take place in only 12.3% of South African policing precincts. And because of the murder rates that we are working on and calculated, we know that these areas contain 33% of the country's population. So we start asking questions about this. So using murder rates per 100,000 population allows us for comparisons of where high risk of murder occurs between different precincts. Because, you know, one of the things that has driven us to get to this point is the fact that we always get those questions that was mentioned this morning. Which is the most dangerous city? What is the most dangerous area? Is Johannesburg really the most dangerous city in the world, or is it Cape Town? And if you try and explain that it's not that simple to compare, you know, people make their own assumptions. And there are studies out there internationally that are quite dangerous to our reputation. So the question is, what can we compare and what can't we? And that's what we were trying to do. Can we combine this database in such a way that it could give us some socioeconomic indicators and of high murder areas? So we are looking at whether the risk of murder is associated with certain demographic characteristics. Is there a way that we can explain some of our murder through, on a community and societal level, through some of the census data? And we know it was a long shot, but we had some surprising results. We keep on using the term murder because the crime stats talk of it's got a murder definition, just to clarify.
Okay, hello. My name is Ellen. I'm going to take you a little bit through the methodology we used in this analysis. We are very open to suggestions of how to improve it and how to deal with certain of the limitations we have. As Lizette was saying, it's very hard to compare the police precincts to each other. ISAs have mapped them. We've mapped the murder figures for all the police precincts. And you can sit, I mean, I live in Fairland in Johannesburg, and next to us is the Honeydew police precinct. And they might have the same number of murders, but they might have five times the number of people that are living in that precinct. So to compare that, we need to figure out a way to look at what is the population. We've used, I think in 2013, Stats SA released a small area data, which is the very small little sub-areas of analysis for census. And we've overlaid the spatial boundaries of that with SAPS precincts. Now, the SAPS precincts are not in the same boundaries. The boundaries of the precincts do not coincide with the boundaries of the wards, which is very, that would have been the simplest way, or with the boundaries of even the small areas. When we did the overlay, and I've put that picture in, it's a bit hazy, but if you can look at the red boundary, that is the boundary of a precinct. And within that, you see the little gray areas. Those are the small areas, which is the lowest level of analysis of census data. So we've overlaid the two, and we found that 96% of the small areas fall completely within a police precinct. So that's great. Those people and all the information we have on them can be put into that precinct. The remaining 4%, what we had to do was a bit of a rough shot kind of analysis. We looked at their spatial, how many square kilometers is it, and how many square kilometers falls into precinct A, and how many square kilometers falls into precinct B. And then we divided the population for those overlapping areas into those precincts. So that is a bit, there are some limitations to that, and we'll get to that later. So the census was done in 2011, as you all know. That's the last census we've got. We are now looking at, last year we looked at 2014 crime stats. So we had to adjust for some of the population growth that took place. And unfortunately, again, the Stats SA releases mid-year population estimates. And the lowest level that they release it on, the population growth or decrease, is on a district municipality level. So we applied for all the district municipalities areas, we applied the same growth rate, which does not allow for like small area mobility. But by doing this, we managed to link the census data that we have to police precinct crime stats. And that was one of the things we've been working on for quite a while. And we feel that with the small area level data, we actually managed to get quite an accurate estimate of population per precinct, firstly, which allows us to calculate crime rates per precinct, but also the socioeconomic statistics linked to that. Okay, so here you see more precincts and much more areas. And obviously, if you expand this to the whole of South Africa, that's how we applied this methodology. Okay, this was the original crime maps that ISS produces. We have murder incidents per precinct, and they mapped for all the precincts in South Africa. We mapped the number of murders, and you can then see which precincts have a very high number of murders. I mean, we can all see that from the crime stats that get released. You just sort them, and you can see, okay, those are the precincts that have very high murders. But we can't see from this how many people are in those areas. Can we really compare them this way by looking at pure numbers, or do we really need to look at the rates? So the next figure shows you the murder rates per precinct. Now, that's quite a different picture if you look at that compared to that. So I'd like to let that sink in a little bit. One of the things that you can see immediately there is that there are quite a few precincts in the Northern Cape which have a very high murder rate. Now, any guesses what would be happening there? Okay, I can give you an example. The one on the top left in the very red area there is a precinct which only has 1,400 people living in it. So there were two murders in 1 year. And that murder rate is now through the roof because they have so few people. So even looking at murder rates, we have to be very careful about how we analyze it. For our analysis, we had to exclude some of the smaller police precincts to get rid of those enormous fluctuations caused by one or two murders. So for some of the analysis, we've looked at police precincts with more than 20,000 people. It's a bit of I don't like getting rid of data. From a research perspective, to sideline a whole of my data is not nice, but sometimes you have to deal with it that way. But this is a map showing the crime rate per precinct. And it looks very different to that one. Okay. When we looked at we look at all the police precincts with a very high murder rate. And we looked at the police precincts where half of South Africa's murders take place. In this case, we excluded those small stations because we felt they would be causing too much noise in a way. So we excluded the smaller stations from this graph. You can see that 34% of those precincts fall in the Eastern Cape, and 18% in the Western Cape, 22% in KwaZulu-Natal, and 14% in Gauteng. So those are the precincts where half of the country's murders are taking place in terms of sorted by their population, or sorted by their murder rate, sorry. To take it a step further, we wanted to look at socioeconomic drivers. As Lizette explained, we've heard this morning about the individual and the relationship factors, which are probably the biggest drivers of direct murders. We wanted to look at those outer layers of that ecological model and say, okay, what are the community factors? What's in the community could determine what happens to the murder rate? I'm a bit of a number cruncher, so I like throwing figures into models and see what happens. So I did a very rough linear regression. Sorry. And as independent variables, we looked at census data per police precinct. One that we used was population density, the argument being that if you have a lot of people crowded in a very small space, you're more likely to get violent behavior than if there's a farm there and maybe a few people there. The heterogeneity index is an indicator for the diversity within a precinct. Kelly spoke about the history in this country. We looked at, there's some theories that say if you put more people from different groups into an area, they are more likely to cause issues. So the level of heterogeneity would be an indicator for violence. Urbanization, the percentage of people with low income below 1,600 rand a month as per census 2011. That's household income. The percentage of people that are unemployed, the percentage of households living in informal housing, the percentage of households renting their house in terms of social mobility. People are not linked to the area. They're not invested in a certain community. They might be more likely to commit crimes. The percentage of female-headed households also being an indicator of maybe family structures that might not be ideal, and the percentage of people with primary education or less. So those are the variables we looked at in terms of the census, and then we looked at and how much they influence the murder rate in that precinct. Okay, it's very technical, but that's basically what we looked for, and that's the data we had available. Here are some examples. I don't know if you can read this. The first two columns. So what determines this? What is the difference there? And obviously, if we look at all 1,000, how many have we got now? 1,139 police precincts. obviously you'd like to see what is causing this. The third column and the fourth column show typically less densely populated areas, Lephalale in Limpopo and Beaufort West in the Western Cape. And again, we have areas with similar population sizes that have, the one has a very high murder rate or comparably high murder rate, and the other one has a pretty low murder rate. So there's differences there, even in the areas that look like initially look the same or similar. And then at the last column, I showed you that map with those outliers, the very red areas because they've got very low population. On the last column, I've picked out one police station, and these are pretty, there's no specific reason why I picked these out. I just wanted to show you differences. Where the murder rate is 239, which is very high. But if you look at the population size, you'll see why. There were only three murders in a population of 1,200 people. So this is one of those rural areas with a huge police precinct with very few people in, where unfortunately they had three murders in 1 year, and it made the murder rate look horrendously high. This is just to show what those outliers can do. Okay, so this is our independent variables and our dependent variable shown in one table. Here's a regression analysis with all the stations thrown in. And what it shows here is that heterogeneity index, population density, urbanization, low income or poverty, unemployment, the proportion of people renting, and low education all have a significant relation to the murder rate. But anybody with some understanding of statistics will see that if you look at the R squared at the bottom, which is an indicator of how much of your model explains your outcome, you can see it's very low, it's 10%. So then I said, okay, let's have a look at the stations without those tiny little stations in it that cause a lot of noise in the model. Let's have a look what happens there. So this is the same analysis, but with all the stations with more than 20,000 people to see if we could what we could do there. And again, there's a lot of significant influences on the murder rate. And the model now explains about 20% of the variation in the murder rate between the stations. So while this is very low, and I mean, any statistics course I've done, I've always heard, oh no, if your R squared is below, I can't even remember what the value was, but you can't, that's not a good model. No, it's not a good model, but it explains a small part of our murder rate variations between the precincts. Okay, limitations of this model. I've already discussed a few. The census may not be accurate. Counting errors in census can be different for different areas. In rural areas or informal areas, there will be different errors in the counting for census than in other area types. Households may not be evenly distributed within the small areas. So where we had those overlapping boundaries, we just said, okay, surface area that way, surface area that way. We didn't look at where those households were situated, so we might have caused some error there. The census data is only released every 10 years. So we have 2011 data, which is now 4 years old, which is, it causes noise in the model. We can't account for that. We don't have better data for that. There's high mobility in certain areas. People move around, people move into areas, and you can't see that in this data. We can't account for that. And then district municipality growth rates apply to all those small areas may not actually be reflective of what's really happening. The crime stats, Lizette already touched on some of that. Within the precincts, crime might not be evenly distributed. We might have high crime areas. I mean, again, Honeydew is an example because it's close to me. I know the area. There's a large suburb, and then there's an informal area quite close together. So they fall under the same precinct. We can't see that in the murder in the data we get from SAPS. There's underreporting of some crimes. There's differences between daytime population and nighttime population. So where the crime is reported does not necessarily mean these people, the victim lived in that area or the perpetrator lived in that area. We don't know that. So we have to accept that our analysis has that limitation. And like I said earlier, those small precincts with very low populations may cause a lot of outliers or fluctuations in murder rate, you might find that what those same precincts next year look completely different. Okay, conclusions and considerations. Basic socioeconomic analysis on its own does not yield very strong associations, but we can see there is associations. There's a lot of similarities between these police stations. Like I showed you those columns with the two similar looking police stations, but the one has a very high murder rate and the other one has a very low one. So the similarities are almost more striking than the differences if we look at a lot of these socioeconomic factors. Again, I mean, the drivers of crime, like murder, might be much more, they are much more complicated than just the socioeconomic status. Understanding murder requires multi-level analysis derived from numerous data sources and may require different methodologies. It would be incredibly interesting to know how many gun licenses are in each area, in each police precinct. I don't have the data. I wish I had it. There's so much more that we could add to this if the data would be available. I love data. Give me the data and I'll analyze it, but it's not available, especially on this level. So, you know, that's one of those things that we'd really like to look at. The limited data that's available at precinct level limits the analysis we can do to some very basic socioeconomic factors. Again, there's so much more. We don't know about the number of cases of domestic violence that are reported. If we could link that to the murder rates, there's so much more that we can analyze here if the data would be there. More disaggregated crime data at sub-precinct level or small area layer could potentially yield more meaningful results. We have the population figures for smaller areas, but we don't have the crime data. So if the police would release it, we don't know where in the precinct things happen. We can't see it. We don't know it. We only get these blocks. And some of those blocks are huge, as you've seen on some of the maps. Some of those precincts cover a huge area. And we think the methodology can form a basis for the formulation of more sophisticated measurements to investigate certain associations like poverty, economic deprivation, heterogeneity, mobility, and urbanization. And applying the methodology, we want to apply it to other types of crime. We focused on murder here. We think that applying it to other types of crime, violent crimes, property crimes, might actually give us more insight in those driving factors towards murder too. So we still need to get to that. We've really been exploring the data here that we have. And that's about it. So I'd like to thank you for... Why is it not going through? Okay. I've got another one. Sorry. Can I finish the last chat? The precinct level census information should actually be used for giving information to the police of police station level responses. How does the police determine where they're going to allocate resources? I mean, this data could be used in terms of that to justify and to clarify where resources should be used. Okay, thank you very much.
I remember when Anthony Altbecker published his book, the title of which I cannot remember. Excuse me? The Dirty Work of Democracy. Thank you, Kelly. I think in the first chapter, he uses a metaphor for the number of annual deaths. And he says, well, on average, 47 people die in this country per day. And he uses this metaphor. He says, well, that's a busload of people. So if we start driving these buses for 365 days of the year, we'll fill a stadium of people. And I always thought that the metaphor itself was so tactile. I mean, how can you argue with a busload of dead people? And how can you argue with a soccer stadium full of dead people? To me, it illustrated the gravity of the situation. So from that, I mean, what we've had now is two researchers walking us through the very challenging undertaking of making sense of a soccer field of dead people and the extraordinary difficulties and, you know, the kind of creativeness that I think you have really exhibited this afternoon. So thank you for sharing the kind of backstage story of what it means to be fiddling with stuff called statistics, but to do so in a very responsible manner. So, and then to end off by saying, listen, we actually know nothing. I mean, that's great. So we'll come back for more. But we are going to turn, thank you very much. This is a very good advert, you know, for that thing that you call the Crime and Justice Information Hub. We actually use it quite a lot. Yes. So in the sort of training environment. So we gave you generous time, but we have generous time. So Roxanne, can you join us up here? Roxanne is she's got a background in research psychology, anthropology, and gender women's studies. Now that's a multidisciplinary specimen that we have in front here, and your interests really are in the areas of child safety and injury prevention and many more. But your paper this afternoon speaks to the issue of the unspoken and the unknown, dumping fetuses and babies, and what that tells us about homicide.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm going to be talking about unwanted pregnancies in Gauteng and Mpumalanga. And what we've been doing here is to examine mortality data of dumped abortions and babies. Very gory topic, I know. Some background, this is what the literature says basically. Unwanted pregnancies globally, they've estimated about 80 million unwanted pregnancies out of a total of 210. Pregnancies are actually unintentional.
And can I just check, can you hear at the back?
Can you hear me? I know I speak very softly.
It's okay, you've got a mic, you just need to bond with it.
Okay. So some of the issues that the literature and past research have actually linked to unwanted pregnancies speaks to poverty and lack of financial support, lack of social support, poor restricted access to contraception, older men and young girls having relationships. This usually causes financial dependencies or sexual exploitation, and this leaves young women or young girls in a position where there's a lack of control over resources and a lack of certain choices that they can make, especially in terms of how to deal with unwanted pregnancies. Also, there's the fear and fear of abuse or forced sex, that is linked to condom use, insisting on condom use because that's attached to a lot of stigma as well. And this speaks directly to negotiating safe sex practices. It reflects some of the power imbalances between men and women when it comes to condom use and condom safe sex negotiation. And the stigma that it was referring to is a lot of the times when young girls are actually, or women in this country, are wanting to use condoms, they are associated with being cheating on their husbands or partners, so that the fidelity issue comes up, or the partners feel that they are insisting on condom use because they have an STI or something. So unsafe abortion, if we borrow from the World Health Organization, it is defined as being characterized by a lack or inadequacy of skills of the provider, as it is hazardous techniques and unsanitary facilities that are used. This is where abortion legislation is restrictive, but it's been found that abortion mortality and morbidity tends to be highest. About 19 out of 46 million terminations were illegal in 1995, and some estimations for 2003, they found that almost half of 42 million abortions were unsafe, of which about the majority, which is 97%, were in developing countries. A total of 120,000 unsafe abortions were estimated for the South African region, of which those countries are part of. abortion in South Africa has been decriminalized in 1996 by the introduction of a Choice of Termination of Pregnancy Act. This has been considered as one of the most progressive abortion legislations in the world. It allows terminations of pregnancies up to 12 weeks at the woman's request with no reasons being given. It allows terminations between 13 and 20 weeks of gestation period when there's a medical risk being assessed. In the case of rape or incest, when the woman is of the opinion that the pregnancy will adversely affect her social economic status. It also protects the individual choice of minors, and it basically encourages the minor to consult an adult, a parent, or guardian, but it cannot be refused if she chooses not. So that's very different to a lot of other legislations in the rest of the world. So despite this decriminalization, research actually shows that women are still aborting outside of the legal system. So we ask ourselves why. A lot of research has been done on various issues relating to this, and this is just a synopsis of what was found. Women are looking for a private and quick response. They turn to people in the broader medical community. They look at traditional healers, they look at doctors and nurses. They go to pharmacists for assistance. Obviously, back door, not always official routes. And also, self-induced methods are used. There's an array of that are being used that either result in short-term, medium, or long-term morbidity and even mortality. Also, there are beliefs and knowledge and experiences that inform their decisions to go the unsafe route. There's a belief that terminations are still illegal in this country. Also, some of them have very bad experiences with clinics and service providers, so they believe that they will be treated very badly when they go to institutions or service providers. So they're afraid of staff rudeness, they're afraid of judgment, gossip, that lack of privacy, that sort of thing. Also, a lack of knowledge. They do not know what the legal gestational periods are in South Africa that are allowed to be subject to termination. And also, there are very long waiting lists when they actually do go to official service providers. And because they have to wait very long for second trimester abortions, they end up going alternative routes instead of carrying to term. The illegal dumping and abortions of babies. There's a lot of things happening in the media. Global media reports says that, some examples. So some examples were found in Texas, where legal abortions were dumped illegally. They also have illicit abortions being dumped, as an example of Russia and Thailand. Media reports in South Africa specifically are actually alerting the public to that there's an increase in this phenomenon. Babies and fetuses are found in dumps, dustbins, and gutters. These are basically chance discoveries by strangers, and they offer reasons for this phenomenon ranging from poverty, teenage pregnancies, rape, incest, and unemployment. However, we found no empirical evidence that actually substantiate these claims. Research in South Africa tends to look at legislative environment. It also looks at unsafe abortions and barriers to service delivery, which is all good things that we need to investigate. But none were found that investigates the actual dumping of babies and fetuses. In other words, concealed births and abortions. So the focus of this paper was to examine the mortality data to determine whether the illicit dumping of non-viable fetuses and abandoned babies are indeed increasing, as it is reported in the South African media. So also used the NIMS data for the year 2009 to 2011. And the reason we chose this three-year period is because that was the best data we could have that we could compare, because the years before that, there was a lot of missing data, and it was very hard to look at this phenomenon. We have 9 out of 10 mortuary coverage for Gauteng, and all 19 mortuaries were covered for Mpumalanga. I'll say a little bit more later on about the limitations of this particular data source. So the methodology, the total sample data used to analyze the year period I mentioned. It was exploratory, basically. We used descriptive statistics. We used crude population incidence rates. So we had missing data for age and sex. because the ages were so young, it was abortion remains, so that data simply does not exist. Investigating differences in reporting rates within each province and between provinces. So we looked at totals and percentages. Inferential statistics, we used chi-square analysis, significance within group differences. Between group differences, analysis for that was not performed because the sample size was just too disparate. Areas of analysis, looked at external cause of injury. This is the circumstances under which injury occurred. Also the scenes of injury, place where actual injury occurred. And we'll speak about that later in our limitations as well. And other scenes of injury, additional places of injury that's not captured systematically. Not one of the main categories in the system. To some of the results, for when we actually look at the overall comparisons for Gauteng and Mpumalanga for the three-year period, Gauteng and Mpumalanga both showed that abortions were higher than abandoned babies for 4 years. More specifically, if we look at comparisons by year, the death rates for abortion show steady increase for Gauteng over the 3 years and for Mpumalanga from 2009 to 2010. Abortions remained constant for Mpumalanga between 2010 and 2011. The death rate for abandoned babies showed a decline between 2010 and 2011 for Gauteng and Mpumalanga. And when we did some statistical significance testing, only Gauteng showed significant differences in abandonment-related deaths across the 3 years at both significance levels. So at alpha level 5, we found an increase in abandonment deaths in 2010, a decrease in deaths to abandonment in 2011, and at alpha level 1, we've found only a decrease in the death due to abandonment in 2011. So if we unpack the scene of injuries for abortions and abandonment, in Gauteng, the three top or the main areas were roads, open land, and unknown, place unknown. For Mpumalanga, it was place unknown, other, and private house. When we unpack other, some of the main ones that came up were cemetery, dump site, military base, public toilets, rubbish bins, sewage drains. And other from Mpumalanga mostly was dump sites and sewage drains. So let's interpret. What does this mean? It's a lot of work. Dumping of fetuses and babies is a real public health concern. And more people seem to be discovering the remains of these fetuses and babies. It indicates a possible increase in this phenomenon for both provinces, but we fear that it might just be the tip of the iceberg because we really don't know. The increase in discovery of babies for Gauteng only, the decrease in discovery of deceased babies for Gauteng only, does not mean that there's a decrease in the dumping phenomenon. It just means we're finding less babies that have been deceased. The popular scenes of injury are publicly accessible and provide anonymity. So due to the clandestine nature of the implications of future research and finding the proper samples to do research on these people who are performing these dumping behaviors, makes it very hard to complicate the story. So what does this mean? The need for secrecy outweighs the risk associated with unsafe abortions. An increase in designated reproductive healthcare facilities does not automatically translate into accessible and acceptable services. There's a lack of information, there's perceived poor quality of services, people are being misinformed by staff about services and legislations, and we don't know whether that's intentionally or not. That relates back to the conscientious objection debate that's going on in our country. Also, stigma and judgment that's associated with these practices, and more than half of registered providers are not delivering services due to staff unwillingness. So this has also been found by research. Found no research involving individuals who have dumped before. So in other words, we have to rely on proxies identified by previous research on who these vulnerable groups actually could be. So is it young mothers? Is it mothers in poverty? Are they unemployed, financial dependents? lack of social and financial support? We don't know. There's basically a need for comprehensive and more detailed surveillance that includes information on the remains discovered, characteristics surrounding the death itself, and information about the mother and father of these babies and fetuses, this being the greatest challenge to identify because of the clandestine nation. In conclusion, defining support existing evidence that unsafe abortion is still a major concern in South Africa. There's a need for more rigorous scientific investigation, and it suggests that women of all ages are in need of reproductive health, education, unaware of progressive legal and legislative developments and services, unfamiliar with alternative example adoption services. And it also begs the question, is there a culture that precludes adoption as an alternative? These are some things that comes out of literature that also needs to be explored. Individuals may not know how and where to access these services. And despite legal reforms, termination of pregnancies are very much stigmatized. This is practitioners and clients alike. There's a need to include men as partners in education and interventions and sharing responsibility in reproductive health choices and practices, for example, condom use negotiations. Also, surveillance is inadequate. There's a need to improve data collection systems because there's a lot of things we don't know. Like this research had more questions than answers at the end of the day. Limitations. The NIMS coverage is limited. It excludes Pretoria. It's only limited to two provinces. There's no data on gestational age of fetuses or babies. There's lapse categories in the NIMS that it lapses stillbirths and abortions into one category. And we assume if we exclude natural causes of death, it will exclude the stillbirths. But the possibility is still there that those cases, some of those cases that have been classified as undetermined might still be included in the data that we used. So that's a limitation. Rely on the assumption that can be eliminated with improved data surveillance systems. Assumption that all fetuses found were due to unsafe or illicit terminations. The possibility does, however, remain that some of these remains were returned back to the family for burial and were discarded inappropriately, so that data is no way of knowing. So some of those cases could also be included in our data. And there are discrepancies in how NIMS definitions were applied, for example. The proper way in terms of what the manual tells data capturers to enter when they get these cases for these instances would be place unknown for scene of injury because you don't know where the injury occurred. But that doesn't tell us where they found it. So a lot of the data capturers actually indicated scene of injury as where they found the remains. So the suggestion there would be that they need to standardize the definition and actually introduce a scene of discovery, which would actually clarify that kind of confusion and tell us more at the end of the day. That's all. Thank you.
Roxanne, thank you. I mean, clearly abortion is not just a medical issue. I think what you've described very well this afternoon is that it's a deeply social and cultural issue, and that if we want to come to terms with the issue of dumping of fetuses and babies, we need to go back and revisit the politics, the economics, the culture of abortion. A recurring refrain that I heard was, we don't know. We don't know about situational contexts. We don't know the details of relational issues. We don't know about the politics, big and small. And we also don't know in the most basic of data systems and information. So I think you've carved out a really interesting is not a good word. You've carved out an issue here this afternoon that really cries for more research. So from everybody here, thank you for making a presentation on this issue. And I'm sure that there will be follow-up questions relating to that. So now we have to draw a line in the sand because we're going to shift. So hold your questions for the discussion. And we have Ansie Wichers, who is attached to the Division of Forensic Medicine at the University of Cape Town. She has been trained in lots of things, but what I see is human genetics and forensic science. So please join us. And the title of your presentation is Firearm Fatalities Examined at Salt River Medico-Legal Laboratory, 2009 until 2014.
So I'm the student who was tasked with working with the police for data collection, like this morning. I was holding my breath when people were asking the questions. I didn't want to steal my own thunder with answering questions. So I'm looking at firearm deaths and the firearm deaths in the Cape Western Metropole from 2009, also 1999, and what the investigative outcome was 5 years later. These are two x-ray images, on the left human and on the right cat, just showing that absolutely no one's excluded and everyone is in danger. South Africa has had a very long history of particularly politically motivated gun violence, but since 1994 it has subsided, but due to poverty, unemployment and the increase in the illegal drug trade, there's been an increase in criminal gun violence. And this has been just rife since over the past two decades. Firearm deaths has attracted a bit of attention in the news lately, as shown by this extract from Eyewitness News. This was brought on by a report that was released from the Western Cape Community Safety Department, and this statement was a statement was released by the Minister of Community Safety, Dan Plato, and this was released on the 23rd of August and titled Western Cape Gun Problem, Effective Central Firearms Database. In this, they claimed that the firearm-related murders increased from 22.8% in 2004-05 to 35.5% in 2013-14, and this was in the Western Cape specifically. Firearm-related cases were at their lowest from 2006-07 to 2009-10. I'm assuming these are financial years, that's why it's 19. And in this report, they say they use four police stations in the Western Cape. Nyanga was one and Mitchell's Plain was one, but those two are both seen as urban areas. Then there was Paarl East, which was called a peri-urban area, and Worcester was seen as the rural area. And in this analysis of 300 firearm-related dockets between the time of 1999 and 2014, they found a conviction rate of 20%. And the highest level of conviction was in the Paarl East precinct, and the lowest was in Mitchell's Plain. About 37% of all the cases that they looked at were withdrawn in court, and about 35 were called undetected or unsolved. In 2004, Dr. Liebenberg conducted a study as part of her Master's in Forensic Pathology thesis. It was titled Firearm Deaths Examined at Salt River Medico-Legal Laboratory, or the Cape Western Metropole Service Mortuary, in 1999, and the investigative outcomes by 2004. 527 cases of firearm deaths were examined. They were looked on a case-by-case basis, and the information was obtained from the South African Police Service on the investigative outcome. And this was the outcome was determined 5 years after the incident occurred. A shockingly low conviction rate of only 7.2% was found. And there was an interesting finding that 11 of the cases were committed by one Pagat assassin. And if you take these 11 cases out of the equation, the conviction rate is as low as 5.2%. Since 1999, some things have happened.
In 2009, there was the instigation of the 2000. Sorry, there was the instigation of the new Firearms Control Act of 2000, and some studies indicated that from 2001 to 2005, there was approximately 13.6% decrease in the firearm homicides, and it suggested that theoretically this new act saved 4,586 lives across the country. And in 2010, firearm deaths accounted for 32% of homicides, as opposed to 42% in 2001-2005. Salt River Medical Legal Laboratory comprises a database in which they record all their post-mortem examinations. And this is a graph showing all the firearm deaths recorded from 1999 till August of this year. And the red indicates the total number of firearm deaths, the green the homicide firearm-related deaths, the suicides are in pink, and then there's others, which are accidents or they don't know the manner of death. And in 1999, there were 527 cases. 2001 had the highest number of cases, which was 792. And it's interesting because this was right after the instigation of the new Firearms Control Act. It then started decreasing and reached a lowest point of 280 cases in 2009. And it continued decreasing till about 2011, after which it started spiking. And in 2013, there was quite a big spike. Currently, we are at 460 firearm deaths, and we're projecting that if it goes on at this trend, it's going to reach 690 deaths by the end of this year. So, we've decided to do a follow-up study one decade later for my minor dissertation as part of the Master's in Biomedical Forensic Science. For 2009, there were 280 firearm death cases in the Cape Western Metropole, and this is opposed to 527 in 99. And we looked at the investigative outcome 5 years later, so by the end of 2014. And we were wondering whether this decrease in firearm deaths would have made an impact on the investigative outcome or the judicial process of these cases. There are 13 main investigative outcomes that we looked at. The four big categories is, first, a case could still be investigated or still open, or it could have reached a dead end. It could also still be in the judicial process, or it could have been concluded in court. And this last one has three categories, which is the case has been withdrawn in court, a person was acquitted or found not guilty, or a person was found guilty. If a case is in the judicial process, it can be in the inquest court, the magistrate's court, or the state prosecutor. The dead ends are the tricky ones because it depends a lot on the type of data collection. So I had the option of a case just being filed, which doesn't mean much apart from it. There's no finding. It was just closed off, and they didn't find anything else. Then the police sometimes say the case is undetected, which can mean one of two things. Either a suspect wasn't prosecuted due to some other reason, or they never identified a suspect through the investigation. Then there are two other dead-end outcomes. One, the suspect is dead, or two, a warrant is out for the suspect's arrest, but the suspect can't be traced. This is a graph showing the main investigative outcomes for 1999 and 2009. The blue stars indicate where there's a significant difference between the 2 years. Some cases had to be excluded, mainly because the case can't be traced, and there was a significant difference. Luckily, in 2009, there was a bit less that had this option. Then, in the cases where the investigation was still ongoing, was about 35% for both years. In 2009, there were many more dead ends, and there were less cases still in the judicial process. But then the cases that finished the judicial process was more or less around 20% for both years. The dead-end outcomes. So for 2009, they had cases of just being filed or undetected, which wasn't in the 99 data. So there were quite a few cases that we just didn't have much more information on it, rather than
and we just know it's a dead end. In 99, there was a significant amount of cases that weren't prosecuted as opposed to 2009. And in both years, the percentage of cases where the suspect was dead was around 1.5%. Then the percentage of cases where no suspect was identified was about half in 2009 as opposed to 99. And the cases where warrants were out was equally low for both years. Then the cases that are still in the judicial process, there were the biggest differences were with the cases that were still in the magistrate's court or in the with the state prosecutor, with 2009 being much lower than 99 in both instances. And the percentage of cases that were still in the inquest court was more or less the same. This is the slide that we're probably most interested in, and it's the cases that completed the judicial process. There were no significant differences between 99 and 2009 for any of the three outcomes. About 40% of the cases that did complete the judicial process were withdrawn in both years. And in 99, 8.3% of all firearm deaths were withdrawn, and 9.6% in 2009. And the cases that were found not guilty, they were 4.2% in 99 and 6.4% in 2009. And then the guilty verdicts. We have 7.2% for 99, which is even lower if accounting for the assassin at 5.2%. And for 2009, this was 5.7%. So even though there was a 47% reduction in the number of firearm deaths in the Cape Western Metropole in 2009 versus 99, the investigative outcomes do not look any better. There was no significant difference in the number of convictions, acquittals, or withdrawals, but there were more dead ends as well. The decrease seen in the firearm deaths since 2004 to 2001 also did not last for very long, as shown in the next slide. Once again, the trends of the deaths, firearm deaths in the Cape Western Metropole. And to me, it doesn't seem as if it follows the Y equals MX plus C equation. So, the government is making new laws, taking away guns, spending money on fighting crime, yet lead poisoning by firearms continue. And worst of all, with a conviction rate of 5.7%, shooters get away with it. I would like to acknowledge my supervisors, Drs. Liebenberg and Haynes, and the South African Police Service for their cooperation, especially Colonel Ntsezo and Sergeant Yankees, then the Harry Crosley Foundation at NRF, and the Forensic Medicine and Toxicology Division at UCT, and Calvin Law.
Thank you, Ansie, for doing what you did at the end, thanking everybody. That's it's a nice kind of framework for collegiality. But thank you also for taking us through the very difficult exercise of actually putting the basic building blocks in place to begin to read in a more intelligent manner patterns of homicide in this particular instance. And as in the case of your colleague, there's so much more work to be done. How do we understand why patterns of investigation look like they do? It seems to me that you're also opening up a research area for inquiry where people with other disciplinary interests may wish to participate. Okay, so spectacular. We're going to open the floor. We've got 16 minutes for this conversation, so it needs to move kind of, you know, at a quick pace. Otherwise, you're not going to get your slot. And I've got one hand, Jean. I've got two, three. Do I have more? Do you want to be in line? Yes, four. Excuse me, ma'am. Is your hand up or are you just, yeah, okay. Jean, go for it.
Lizette and Ellen, for your hard work. I'm one of the few people that knows what's involved in actually lining those boundaries up and getting a data set to work with. So well done on doing that. I did something similar a few years ago, and the model that with Michael O'Donovan, and the model that we got to explained about 52% of violent crime. And I think some of the variables you're missing are the percentage of young men in the population, measures of inequality, and for this we had to look at the neighboring suburb rather than the within the suburbs themselves. And you find that income is often a proxy of inequality with the neighboring suburb. And also extent of orphaning, which actually worked in the opposite direction from what one expected. Extent of orphaning. So those are just some suggestions on how you might improve your model.
My question's for Lizette and Alan. You, or maybe Alan, will answer this. You say that you use simple linear regression. So you didn't use multiple or multi-level. You didn't use multi-level or hierarchical regression. But stating, I mean, just considering the fact that you have multiple factors. But then my other question was that the appropriate test, given the fact that it's count data and, you know, we can't uphold the assumptions of normally distributed data, independent observations or collinearity would be a problem, homoscedasticity. So would the log linear approach not have been a better model?
And thanks again for very interesting presentations. My question is for Roxanne, or maybe more of an observation in relation to your research. The common call for statistics and data, I think it's going to be the chorus in any research in South Africa at this stage. It was nice to see that your findings of abandoned or aborted fetuses are in public toilets in the majority, because it sits with my own observations in terms of what I found. In the majority of cases, I found that they're reported by people who clean the toilets. And the people who clean the toilets live in the area. Has there been any consideration given in relation to contextualizing their stories? It gives a better insight into your type of research.
Thanks. Just a quick point for Roxanne. I really enjoyed your presentation, Roxanne, thanks. And I'm constantly struck in Johannesburg, all over the city, how there are these two posters that go up all over the city together. The one is for penis enlargement, and the other is for safe abortions. And it's across the city, and it demands research. I think how these two things go together. They speak very much to me of the ongoing patriarchy in our society. So one question is, do you use the P word and not? And if not, why not? Is there a gendered analysis here around patriarchy and around, because it didn't come up in your work, so I'm just wondering if there's a reason why you don't speak to explicitly feminist politics and theory in your research. And the other is just to say that there's a PhD student from BITS Department of Anthropology who's been doing research on dumping and abandonment. She's been doing ethnographic research. And one of the interesting things that she's been finding, particularly in work with Joburg Child Welfare, is that there seems to be the variable in whether people come forward to give up their children for adoption or dump is around South Africans who are from urban areas and rural women and immigrants. So a lot of the women who live in Joburg have a sense of their own right to services in the city, whereas people who come from other countries or who come from rural areas are generally the women who are more likely to dump babies. So I think it speaks a lot to your point about education, entitlement, and a sense of right to services in the city.
Thanks, Elrena. I actually think I've forgotten what I was going to ask now. But just some comments around abandoned babies, concealments of birth, non-viable fetuses, et cetera, and especially that which can be inferred from the NIMS data in this regard. So, and I'd have to say, just having the experience of that data for a very long time, that not much actually can be inferred, I'm sorry to say, about especially about those categories, just because of the of what they are and the way that the forms get completed. And in the majority of cases, those forms are not completed by pathologists. And Mpumalanga doesn't have a forensic pathologist, as far as I'm aware. So it's just a cautionary, I think, on using data and how you use data. But what I can say is that just then from the stories of where babies are being dumped in Gauteng compared to the Western Cape, they're not being dumped in toilets in the Western Cape. So that much I, so there is maybe something to have a look at why and what and how. But also to say when babies are dumped, they're either a non-viable fetus or they're a viable live birth that has been just left and then dies of something else like exposure, which is still a murder, or they are murdered live-born babies, or they are stillbirths that the mother doesn't know what to do with and puts on a rubbish dump. So the abortion, the termination, all that category that the NIMS form is collecting doesn't define between any of those things, and you actually have to go to mortuary. You have to go to autopsy reports, where a proper autopsy has been done, where the pathologist who's done the autopsy has made the decision whether it was a viable fetus or a non-viable fetus, whether it was a live birth or not a live birth. And then there's the whole debate around what is viable. Is there a legal definition of viability, or do they just leave it up to us to decide, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's just a cautionary around using that data for that particular group of deaths.
Okay, so thank you very much. A wide range of issues. I mean, Jean, your point was more, it wasn't a question, it was simply adding to the number of variables that you may want to consider, given the fact that you love what you're doing. You may as well stick it into the pot. Okay, so that deals with Jean. But then we had some very difficult statistical questions about regression analysis. And I suspect that at least the center of criminology is completely lost, you know, when it comes to that. But I mean, we have a very astute audience. So I don't know whether you want to speak to that. It's about what kind of dumped fetus are we talking about? Which is, I think, just, you know, a very good reminder of how none of these categories should be taken for granted. That there is variability and diversity built into the phenomenon of dumped fetuses. So you've got more than enough to talk about. So go for it. I don't know whether you want to start.
I just want to say thanks to Jean. I think your comments are very valuable. I think we need to take a step back because it will answer some of your questions. Is that we've been sitting with this methodology for quite some time because I think it's very useful in the way that we develop the Crime and Justice Information Hub to have communities, give communities access to their own information. So the idea is that if we're happy with this, and it's been there for a while, that we actually make it publicly available. So communities can access the maps of the crime statistics as they can already and linked to census information. So that was the aim of it. But we decided we want to see how useful we can make this data, and hence the analysis. So it's exploratory at this stage, because we really wanted to understand if there's any value in further analysis and taking the variables that there are, and Ellen can speak some more about some issues even with the interdependency of the variables and so forth. But we wanted to see if there's anything further, and that justifies more donor funding going into to more analysis and more time. So that's a decision hopefully you can all help us make. So that's just what I wanted to say, but thank you. I wanted to also point out that a lot of this information would be gained from a victim survey had it been to the extent that we could actually give it geographical reference, but we can't. So we are looking at other ways, whether it is the NIMS data, which I do have some little experience with, which is a nightmare. So I take my hat off to Roxanne. But yes, so if you know of any others and things we can test at a more local level, we would really appreciate your help. Thank you.
Yeah, I've got not much more to add, but I mean, to answer your question, yes, there's definitely room for better, improved analysis there. We did run correlations between all the variables that we put into the model, and they're almost all related. I mean, that's the problem with social stats, unfortunately, is that poverty is related to unemployment is related. They're not, I mean, I'm, as you heard with the intro, I'm technically a biomedical researcher, so medical stats seem to be easier to deal with. But I think there's definitely room for improvement, and I think we just want to move beyond the step of pure descriptive statistics and move into more. Yes. Probably not. But we need to work on that. We need to improve that. We just moved on a little bit beyond purely descriptive tables. And, yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you for your comments and questions. Okay, I'm going to start at the beginning. The first one was about the public toilets and the people who actually discover the remains. So it's not just for the example of those who actually find remains in public toilets, but in general, cleaners who clean dustbins and so on. This would definitely be a very interesting avenue for future research. We were exploring the NIMS data at that point in time, and like I said earlier on, we found more questions and more areas to be investigated than anything else. So we did very basic analysis on very poor information that we had, but the exercise for us was to also improve our own information system. So this also answers the lady at the back's question. It was an internal exercise for us, and we made a whole list of things that NIMS should include, because there's a lot of information that's falling through the cracks. So this list was, because NIMS was at the time was under revision, and they're trying to make it an automated system, not just paper trail, we forwarded these suggestions, and we're hoping that it will be installed, because if you are really going to surveil this phenomenon properly, you need to know the specifics around the remains being found. There's a lot of information that you can't find, but there are a lot of things that can be captured if you pay more attention to the issue. And traditionally, with NIMS analysis, this data specifically has always been excluded in all analysis. So this is what got me interested in the first point, instance, is that why are we always excluding the abandoned babies and the stillbirths and all these categories? Why isn't anyone looking at what are the trends and patterns that's emerging? Yeah. So this was the first piece of information that actually looks at that data, because traditionally when all NIMS analysis, this has been excluded. So definitely this is something that needs to be under the microscope, and we've been advocating for that and to change our own surveillance system. So we've been very critical about our own system, and not very popular for it, but it needs to be done. The big P word, the patriarchy, not penis. For the paper, we touched on some of those aspects, but because it was for the South African Medical Journal, we had to kind of keep it within the framework. But they've invited us to write an editorial on it, and that's where we brought in all these issues. So we speak about patriarchy, and we speak about why we should look at the reasons behind women feel that they should choose abortion in the first place. Because yes, legitimately, there are women who do not want children or do not want any more children. But there are also women that we feel that they feel they don't have a choice but to abort. So that's not a choice at all. So we make the argument in that editorial that it's a form of structural violence. This is why women feel they do not have the option other than to abort. Women are being disabled by or disempowered by structural and social pathologies, which is not necessarily always in their control, but because of the context and the environment that they are in, the conditions. We're saying that sometimes the choice to abort has as much to do with the circumstances around that woman than the actual child, him or herself. And that's not been investigated. We're all advocating for making services accessible, making it acceptable, but we're not asking the hard questions like, why is this woman in need of an abortion in the first place? Those are the things we advocate in the editorial, and I strongly recommend that you read it. Yeah. So, do I answer everyone's questions? I think I missed.
Any more questions, particularly around perhaps the investigative investigation of firearm fatalities? Andy, and then two, and then three. And I hopefully they will be short questions. Okay, Andy, go for it.
Yes. I just want to ask Roxanne about like health providers opting out, like the debate about conscientious objectors, like just to expand on that, and health providers not willing to provide or do the procedures for abortion.
Would you like me to? Could you just repeat the last bit, please?
It's basically just asking to hear more about the debate on conscientious objection and why is it health providers can opt out, and just hear more about the conversation around that.
Okay, I think that's about as much time as we have. But Ansie, I don't want you to leave here without having had a question. So may I pose the question? The question is very interesting, looking at investigative outcomes. And again, you're putting in place the building blocks for us. The raw data, analysis of data, looking at trends 2009-2014. When you start engaging the question as to why investigative outcomes look like they do, do you peep into the criminal justice system and the disarray within the police as a possible contextual factor? Or are you leaving that to the center of criminology? It's just, again, the kinds of questions that we can pose to ripple outwards from the focus that you have. Okay, so we've got 4 minutes left. Ansie, maybe you want to speak.
I think I would like to leave it to the criminalists, but yeah, I've thought about it because when I started doing the study, I thought, wow, the numbers are so low, and that's why we initially went to look at the other years, because I thought something funny was just going on there. And I thought, no, this must make sense, because one of the main arguments is the police are overworked. So they have half the cases, so it must be, clearly they must do better at it. But I think it is the police, but also then the courts. The fact that some of the cases, one, some of them never go to court, they just die off. And for me, it's alarming that it's firearm deaths that this happens to, because ballistic evidence usually provides good results and they are usually witnesses and things. So I wouldn't expect it. But so the fact that it seems as if there's a lack of investigative outcomes, but then also the fact that cases are withdrawn from courts, to me, is seemingly easily. 40% of cases that, because before they go to court, the prosecutor has to decide whether there's enough evidence to prosecute. So someone else thought that there's enough evidence, but then by the time they go to court, it doesn't seem good enough. So I think something is happening in court. Dan Plato seems to think that it's the witnesses who get scared, which I could very well believe. But it's very difficult to figure out the reasons for these things happening, and you don't want to accuse people willy-nilly. But I think it's alarming.
I'll be quick. The first question about the link between fetuses and using for traditional medicine or mutu, I have not looked into it personally, and I would not be able to answer that question. Short and sweet. I have heard rumors and things like that, but nothing empirical or anyone that I found that actually investigated it. So I don't know. Conscientious objection. Basically, the debate is still ongoing, and it's a very contentious issue, and there's no clear-cut response to that because of the heterogeneity within each of the populations. Like, basically, it comes down to the constitutional rights of all individuals in this country that is protected, your right to choice to believe in whatever you want to believe in. And that is the same for doctors as it is for the women looking for an abortion. Now, a lot of people are saying that doctors should not have that choice if they've taken an oath to provide medical services to the population. And but what we've also learned from our country is no matter how you enforce policy, even if you take that right away or you put some kind of enforcement, implementation in our country with policy has not been the strongest, it's not been the strength of our country. So what happens in practice is even though doctors feel that service providers feel they have to provide services, at the end of the day, it's up to them whether or not to refer. The legislation says if they conscientiously object not to provide the services, they have to refer. But for that person, that individual, if they feel like they're enabling a behavior that they conscientiously object to, they won't refer either. So in practice, it's much harder to regulate because it comes down to people's belief systems. There's an ongoing debate. Then you get situations where practitioners are saying, I choose not to perform these services. But they do so after hours when there's monetary reward. But this is not generalizable to the whole population, of course. This is the exception. So you have that as well. So it's a very complex issue. There's no clear way of responding to it without looking at the complexity. So it's an ongoing debate.
Okay, so I think we've put some very important information sets on the table. At times it seemed quite rudimentary, but it's a first and very important step to arrive at more sophistication. And then, Roxanne, if you talk about complexity, you know, to move from the rudimentary building blocks to something which paints a more complex picture, hopefully this discussion this afternoon would have invited and enticed many of us to participate in that process. So thank you very much on behalf of the audience for your contribution.
Just take a 20-minute tea break and be back at 10 to 3. We have